Today our topic will be Maxims of Teaching, and this topic is from Unit 1, Paper BEDU 1003, and course name is Teaching and Pedagogical Analysis. Prerequisite for studying this topic is that you should be well aware about the concept of teaching, meaning of teaching and learning. Psychologists introduced the laws of learning. Educationists have presented their experiences and decisions in the form of maxims, considering their laws and elements as the basis of teaching. So, then arises the concept of maxims of teaching, where experiences and decisions and performance are framed and named under maxims of teaching. We teacher needs two things. One, the complete knowledge of the subject matter. Second, the scientific knowledge of the teaching styles for disseminating the knowledge to the pupils. And these two, that is distribution of knowledge and teacher ability, both are separate things. So, maxims of learning will act as a feather to help the teachers in their teaching styles to disseminate the knowledge all they have in a proper way. Good morning, students. Today our topic is Maxims of Teaching, and this is the topic from Unit 1. So first discuss, what do you mean by Maxims of Teaching? Every teacher want to have maximum involvement and participation of the learners in the learning process. He or she sets the classroom in such a way so that it becomes attractive for them. Teacher uses different methods, rules, principles, etc. in order to make the lesson effective and purposeful. Teacher uses general rules or formula and applies it to particular example in order to make teaching learning process easy and up to understandable level of the student. So, every effort done by the teacher to purposefully maximize use of the resources, of the data, of the methods, comes under the maxims of learning. Varied principles, working rules or truth through teaching which becomes interesting, easy and effective are called maxims of teaching. These maxims of teaching have universal significance. Every person who is expected to enter into the teaching profession should be familiarized himself or herself with the maxims of teaching, and the knowledge helps the person to proceed systematically. So there are a number of maxims of teaching which we'll study further in this lecture. So the term maxim of teaching may be defined as rules, principles for presenting difficult terms and concepts to make them easy and to comprehend in the classroom teaching. A teacher employs some specific ways to organize the teaching, to organize the terms, concepts communicable up to the mental process of the learners. And these all techniques, rules, principles, all the teacher apply in her classroom all together make the maxims of the teaching. And a teacher can use any one of the maxims of the teaching from the list provided, and she can choose wisely according to the content she has selected to particular class. Maxims of teaching are based on the universal facts that are founded by the teachers after year of experiences. They are culture free and universal in nature. They are tried and tested principles. These maxims of teaching help to accelerate the movement of teaching and learning process and helps in achieving the momentum of teaching. These are the short statements like dictum that are treated as general rule of the conduct. But one thing I would like to notice, bring to your notice, that all the maxims of teaching we can't use at one time. We have to choose wisely that for which content, which maxim we can use in our classroom. As I told you earlier also, these maxims of teaching are a result of experiences, observations from number of teachers, and they are provided to us that being a teacher educator, we can teach our students, our budding teachers, how they can use these general rules and principles in their classrooms. So list is a long one, like from simple to complex, from known to unknown, from seen to unseen, concrete to abstract, particular to general, whole to part, indefinite to definite, psychological to logical, and empirical to rational. So we have to choose wisely which maxim I have to apply for my class. So first maxim of teaching will be known to unknown. When a child enters in the school, he has some knowledge, he possesses some knowledge, and it is the duty of the teacher to enlarge his previous knowledge. Whenever he possesses should be linked with the new knowledge. If we link the new knowledge with the old one, our teaching becomes clear and more definite. So this maxim facilitates the learning process and encompasses the effort of the teacher and the taught. For example, when a teacher is teaching about something about water, so a teacher should know that this particular child is aware about the general meaning of the water in his mother tongue. So when we use the words from the mother tongue like pani in Hindi and Kashmiri word aam, then the students will be more motivated, the students will be more finding easy to learn that. So this way of teaching helps the learner to understand thankfully. By this the teaching becomes definite, clear and more fruitful. And this maximum is based on the assumption that student knows something. Then to widen his outlook, to enlarge his knowledge, we can use the concept that are already known by him. So it is said that old knowledge serves as a hook on which the new knowledge can be hung. So we as a teacher should always try to use this concept from known to unknown. First we should discuss the things that are already known by the student, and then we have to switch from the things that are unknown to them. Next maxim is simple to complex. In this maxim, we stress on the things that we should first discuss the things which are simpler, and then we should move from simpler to complex, like we do in maths. First, we used to make students learn about addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, and then we switch to board mass formula. So, similarly, we should take the things which are simpler and easy to understand first, and then we should move from simple to complex. By giving an example from mathematics to complex one, but if we reverse this situation, students will be finding himself or herself in a very challenging situation, and he or she may lost the interest in the studies due to complexity of matter. So simplicity and complexity of these subject matter should be determined according to the viewpoint of the learners, not of the teacher. We as a teacher should put ourselves near to the student and understand that what is simpler to them and what is difficult for them. So this maxim helps in learning convenient and interesting for the student when we switch from simple to complex. Next maxim is concrete to abstract. Concrete things are the solid thing, they can be visualized, but abstract things are only imaginative things. So when we start a topic, the child understands more easily when taught through their senses. We use maximal use of sense organs, and never forget that material. On the other hand, if abstract things or ideas are presented, they forget it soon. As Froebel said, our lesson ought to start in the concrete and end in the abstract. For example, when we teach the solar system, we first visualize the sun through our senses and give the concept of 8 planets, galaxies, satellites, meteoroids, etc. Now we can show this model, we can show a model, we can show an image, we can show a video. But in higher classes, when we use the term solar system, then a particular student has an imaginative power and he can just understand what a ma'am is talking about. But if we reverse this situation, it will become very difficult for learners to understand anything. Another example is like when we count, when we teach counting to the student, we first take the help of beads. We first take the help of certain material to make them learn counting. But in the near future, and then they proceed, they do it through digits only and numbers only. No as such requirement or object is required to teach counting. So always remember, our good teaching is only when we move from concrete to abstract, and when they are expertized in something, they have an capacity to learn the concept through abstract mode only. Next maxim is analysis to synthesis. When we divide a thing into easy parts or separate elements, that is called analysis. Dividing a matter into small easy steps, and then it is the process which helps in understanding the hidden elements of a thing or a cause of some incident or behavior. Suppose we want to teach students the structure of a heart, then we have to divide the parts of the heart separately to the students and explain every function of that particular part. After that, students are made to understand the structure of the system or working of the heart. In this way, even a very difficult thing can be easily understood. Again, synthesis is what? Synthesis is just opposite of analysis. All parts are shown as a whole. The process of analysis is easier than synthesis for understanding a thing. The process develops the analytic power of the student. It is the best method of starting the teaching process. For example, again, taking an example from digestive system, we should first analyze the different parts of the digestive system one by one and then give a synthetic view of it. So a good teacher should always proceed from analysis to synthesis. First discuss the different parts, then assemble them, and then tell about the whole function. Next maxim is particular to general. A teacher should always proceed from particular to general statement. General fact, principles, and ideas are difficult to understand, and hence the teacher should always present first particular things and then lead to general things. Suppose the teacher is teaching the continuous tense while teaching the English. So he or she should first all of give few examples, and then on the basis of those, they could make them generalize that this sentence is used to denote an action that is going on at that time of speaking. Hence, a teacher should proceed from particular to general. Next maxim that we are talking about is empirical to rational. Empirical knowledge is that which is based on observation, and experience is about which no reasoning is needed at all, and it is concrete, particular, and simple. We can feel and experience it, like as we do in chemistry titration, as we collect the samples, we just experience and observe all the things. But whereas rational is, on the other hand, rational knowledge is based upon argument and explanation. These explanations can be made from the teachers. These explanations and arguments can be between the students only. But when we proceed from empirical to rational, in empirical, we always use the observation that are made it by the students only. So a better teaching should proceed from empirical to rational, and this maxim is an extension of some of the previous maxims, like simple to complex, when we proceed from concrete to abstract, and from particular to general. It resembles them also. Next maxim that we are going to talk about is that a teacher should move from induction to deduction. Now first let's discuss what is induction. Induction is taking example first and then coming to the conclusion, laws, facts, and theories. So process of deriving the laws, rules, and formulae from particular example is called induction. That means first we'll give number of example, then we'll come to the conclusion part, which includes the law and fact. It means drawing a conclusion from set of examples. On the other hand, deduction is just opposite of induction. In it, we derive a certain particular conclusion from laws, rules, and principle. For example, in language teaching, before giving the definition of a noun, the students are acquainted with the examples of noun like man, chair, Delhi, etc. And then they are lead to the general definition of a noun. So a good teacher should always proceed from induction and finishes at deduction only. The next and very important maxims of learning is that we should move from psychological to logical. Modern education gives more emphasis on the psychology of the child. The child psychology development is of utmost importance than any other thing. A teacher while teaching should follow this maximum that includes psychological to logical. Now, psychological approach takes into the consideration the interest of the pupil, the abilities, aptitudes, development level, needs and reaction. So, a teacher should keep in mind the psychological selection of the subject matter to be presented before the pupils. Now, logical approach consider the arrangement of the chosen content into the logical order and steps. It is the child-centered maximum. For example, a teacher tells the story of a poem to the student. When they are not interested in reading, will this teacher proceed from psychological to logical consequences? Okay, so we should take in account the mood, the interest of the student, their understanding about that particular topic, and then we should start from that particular point. And we should take into the consideration these all psychological aspects, which includes creativity, intelligence, aptitude, interest of the student, and then we should move from psychological to logical aspect. Next maxim that we'll be talking about is actual to representative. First-hand experiences make learning bit efficient than to give them representative ones. A teacher, while selecting the content for presentation, should make all the efforts possible to present it through actual, natural or real objects. Then, from their improvised representatives like picture and model. Suppose a teacher visited a golden temple Amritsar. So teacher can collect number of pictures, a real pictures where she is included, or teacher can make an excursion of the students to visit Lal Killa, golden temple or certain museum which are related to their chapters only. Because that thing will be more vivid and pupil will retain it for a longer time in spite of teaching through sketches, model or picture. So, representative form should be used at the higher classes than in the lower classes. But in lower classes, suppose we want our students to learn the concept of a market. So, we should take them to the market only. We should teach them that this is a local market, this is a mall, this is a neighborhood market. These things will help them in junior classes, these things will help them to retain the concept for a longer period. Like we are taking the concept of herbs, shrubs, climbers and trees. So we can take the students to the garden and we can use the real concept. We can use the real trees, plants, shrubs, herbs to make the concept more understandable to them. Instead of writing on the board that herb has a weaker stem and climbers need a support, we can give a live example to them and that thing will retain with them for a longer period. So always a teacher should try to create situation from actual to representative one only. Before discussing the next maxim of teaching, whole to part, I would like to remind you that in the same presentation we have studied the analysis to synthesis, where I have quoted that we should divide the content into different part and then we can move from analysis to synthesis. But we can another maxim is whole to part. Look, these maxims are observation of educationists from number of teachers, and every maxims we can't use in a single classroom. We should use that maxim, that rule that fits in our situation, that can fit in our lecture only, that can fit in according to my content. So another maxim is whole to part. Whole to part is what? This maxim is the offshoot of the Gestalt theory of the learning, whose main emphasis was to perceive things or object as a whole and not in the form of part. Whole is more understandable, motivating and effective than the parts. In teaching, the teacher should first give a synoptic view of the lesson and then analyze into different parts. For example, teacher while teaching the pollination in plant, he or she should first take the flower, then analyze it into different parts and can give the detailed information about each and every part like the sepals, petals, androecium, gynoecium, etc. In this way, maximum learning is possible. but again it is the reverse of the analysis to synthesis. So teacher should choose wisely which maxim he or she can select from that particular content. All maxims can't be used at the same time. Next maxim is from definite to indefinite. A teacher should always start from definite because definiteness has its limited boundaries and jurisdiction than indefinite things. Suppose we want to take a topic from of one and many. So definite examples are car, cars, toy and toys, but indefinite one is then when we are having a vowel at the end, like beauty, beauties. So we learn indefinite things on the basis of definite things. All are like this, we have to apply S or ES, but where there are CH or where there are Y, I have to apply IES in one to many rule. So definite things, definite rules of grammar help learner to have good knowledge, and gradually he can be taught about the indefinite things. So definite things are easy to understandable. Then after grasping the concept through definite mode, we can switch from definite to indefinite modes of maxims of learning. Again, I want to quote that each and every maxim I can't apply at the same time. I have to choose wisely according to my topic, according to my student, which maxim I can use efficiently and effectively for my students. So it totally depends upon the teacher which maxim she should use. I have just disclosed that there are number of maxims, there are number of approaches, from simple to complex, from definite to indefinite, from known to unknown, from inductive to deductive. It is again the choice of the teacher which maxim she should use, she should select accordingly for her students. And in next lecture, we'll study about the phases of teaching.